when you hear Australia's heroes marching? Can you hear them as they march into eternity? There will never be a greater love. There just couldn't be a greater sacrifice. There just couldn't be.
Can you hear Australia's heroes marching? The ones who fought and gave their all?
There will never be a greater love. There just couldn't be a greater sacrifice. There just couldn't be.
Can you hear Australia's heroes marching? They're marching once again across our great land.
Can you hear Australia's heroes marching?
Can you hear
them as they march into eternity? There will never be a greater love. There just couldn't be a greater sacrifice.
Can you hear Australia's heroes marching?
Former and current servicemen and women, special guest Senior Airman First Class Tiffany Hedberg from the Kenmore Mogul sub-branch of the RSL, trumpeter Mr. Damon Lockheed, our instrumental music teacher, parents, family members, staff members and students, thank you for joining us to commemorate ANZAC Day on Saturday the 25th of April.
Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander viewers are advised that the following program contains images and voices of people who've died.
They're the Indigenous men and women who fought bravely for our country.
Warrant Officer Leonard Waters, first Indigenous man accepted into the Royal Australian Air Force, served in World War II.
Private James Maynard, injured in 1918 during World War I.
Charles Alley fought in the Light Horse Brigade in World War I.
Warrant Officer John Enchong fought in Malaya and the Korean War.
They weren't really recognised for what they had done, and they had done so much for our country and they didn't really get the recognition they deserved.
Despite fighting for Australia for generations, Indigenous people weren't always allowed to enlist in the military. At the start of World War I, non-Europeans weren't allowed to sign up. But at least 1,000 Indigenous people still found their way onto the front lines overseas. Over the years, many Indigenous servicemen and women have died in conflicts too. And that's why Indigenous veteran ceremonies like this one are held to commemorate the fallen.
I'd like to acknowledge and pay my respects to the traditional owners of the land in which we meet today. It is our privilege to attend school on and share this land with the First People of Australia.
Very early in the morning of the 25th of April 1915, when it was still dark,
36 large rowing boats loaded with Australian and New Zealand soldiers and towed by naval boats left the protection of the larger British ships and set off the beaches of Gallipoli. They were about to invade Turkey in the first major military action involving the newly formed nation of Australia. By 2 o'clock that afternoon, some 12,000 men had landed. Later that day, some very brave Australians reached the heights overlooking the beaches. However, they were soon forced to turn back, never to return.
Originally, ANZAC was not a proper word. It was a set of initials that described the Australian and New Zealand soldiers who were in Egypt in the First World War. The initials stand for Australian and New Zealand Army Corps. It was because of the way the Australian and New Zealanders worked together and faced the hardships and dangers that confronted them that the initials became a word, ANZAC. I would like to invite Miss Tiffany Hedberg to say a few words.
Good morning. As I began considering ANZAC Day in early March, I had thought you may be interested to hear my service story. I know that story well, so I parked the preparation of that tale for the time being. Only a short time, however, because in the days following that thought, Australia and truly the rest of the world has become a different place. The planet right now is in a very real war against an invisible enemy. And because life has changed so much at such a rapid pace, I don't need to explain what is happening to any of you. You can't go out to the movies or have a birthday party or even meet your friends at the park. These are big changes. And coming back to ANZAC Day and throughout history, the Allied forces have come together to defeat a common enemy. Today, enemies of the past and allies alike are working together to defeat this invisible adversary. If there's a positive to this pandemic, it is that we have quickly learned that we are all one people and we are all in this together. As a comparison, past members of our community and past family members fought on the front lines for our current way of life and well-being. And now it's you, it's all of us, who are standing on the front lines of this battle, protecting older members of our family and community as they are the ones most at risk. The front lines are not like they were for our grandparents because they face their enemy at close distance, weapons ready. We cannot see our enemy, but we must behave like the enemy is 2 meters away because it could be. And although it has been challenging, it certainly is a sacrifice we can make. Our great history is abundant with the few sacrificing for the many. Now, however, the many are sacrificing for the few. Again, it's a sacrifice we can make because this sacrifice is restriction, not combat. It is being mindful of our own personal space and staying at home. These sacrifices won't harm us. In fact, they will cause us to appreciate the small pleasures in life and provide great opportunities for family time that we may sometimes all take for granted. Amazingly enough, we are protecting the generation who lost many lives over several wars and conflicts years ago. Lost lives in order to give Australians the opportunities and lifestyle we currently enjoy. We can repay this debt of gratitude to them by continuing to follow our country's current laws and restrictions. Let's consider it our duty. Finally, it's definitely worth mentioning that Australia is leading the world, leading the rest of the world and our very own allies in this battle. Indeed, the USA and the UK especially are looking to us for our leadership in conquering this pandemic. It is not a time to gloat, but a time to be thankful and proud of how our country has handled this crisis. Keep up all the positive hard work you've done and hold special thoughts in your hearts and your minds for other countries around the world and our closest of allies who are doing it very tough. I wish you and your family the safest ANZAC Day, lest we forget.
I now invite our special guests, followed by students with wreaths, to come to the front and lay them, beginning with the preps.
And now a reef from the Parents and Citizens Association. The ode that will now be read is read in the Defence Force when one of their soldiers has died. It is also read to remember those hopeful soldiers who have died in battle in the past. It talks about the young, hopeful soldiers going to war and the fighting they faced. It talks of the soldiers who have died. They wouldn't have grown old like the other soldiers because they died on the battlefield. It reminds us to remember that they gave their lives for us, and we should always think of them and the world they allowed us to have. For the Fallen, by Lawrence Binion. They went with souls to the battle. They were young, straight of limb, true of eye, steady and aglow. They were staunch to the end against odds uncounted. They fell with their faces to the foe. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. In a moment, you will hear the last post. It is usually played by a bugle. A bugle is like a trumpet, but without keys. During war, a bugle player in the army would play the last post at nighttime to indicate that the camp was properly guarded and it was time for the soldiers to go to bed. Today, the last post is played at funerals of men and women who have served Australia in the armed forces and at special services such as our ANZAC ceremony as a final farewell to those who have lost their lives. It symbolises that the duty of the soldiers is over and they can rest in peace.
After the last post plays, please stand silently for 1 minute with your head bowed to show respect and think about those who have served our country so that we can live in freedom and peace today. You will then hear the rouse. It is used to call soldiers to their duties. Today it calls us back to our regular day. We are very lucky to have opportunities to learn, develop our skills and be smarter. These opportunities are thanks to those who keep our country, our community, our school, our families safe and peaceful. Everybody please stand up.
Thank you. To New Zealand, who has served alongside us in times of war and peacekeeping operations. If you know the anthem, please show your respect for New Zealand by singing along. We will then sing the Australian National Anthem. Please stand quietly for the national anthems of New Zealand and Australia.
Oh,
my thanks to Senior Airman First Class Tiffany Hedberg, Mr. Lockheed, staff members, students, family members and our PNC Association who have joined us to watch this special ANZAC Assembly today. We send our thoughts and appreciation to the brave soldiers and peacekeepers who are currently working within Australia and overseas to help make our world a better place.
And this year, we send our thoughts and appreciation to healthcare workers, emergency services and defence forces who are on the front line fighting a new fight, the COVID-19 pandemic. We are part of history in the making.
At the end of World War I, about 500 million people were infected with Spanish flu. Soldiers returning from war brought it back to their home countries. It has been said that we have not seen a virus like COVID-19 since 1918 with the Spanish flu.
In 1918, people had never heard of influenza as a virus. So at first, people did not know how to contain it from spreading. But governments knew enough to introduce travel bans, quarantine rules, and social distancing measures. Similar to those today's governments have brought in around the world. During the Spanish flu pandemic, there were widespread efforts to limit contact among people, and they were highly successful in reducing the transmission of the Spanish flu.
We have now been asked to act and respond in a similar manner, and we are hopeful that if we support our government's initiatives to respect the hygiene and social distancing expectations, travel restrictions and limits for gatherings, then we will control and stop the spread of this new virus.
Because of the coronavirus pandemic, ANZAC Day 2020 will be unlike any other. For the first time in a century, the streets will be empty. There will be no suburban dawn services, mid-morning marches, or afternoon two-up matches.
This year, we can show our appreciation to those who defend our nation and recognise past and current armed servicemen and women by joining in a dawn service with a difference. You're encouraged to go to the end of your driveway at 6 a.m. with your family and to share a minute's silence in commemoration of ANZAC Day 2020.
You may also like to create your own poppies or wreaths to lay at your letterbox, or you might like to write a message for our past and present servicemen and women with chalk on your driveway. As you walk around your neighbourhood with your family, look for the poppies, wreaths and messages.
To honour our servicemen and women past and present, we aim to always be respectful towards others, responsible in our actions, resilient when things go wrong, safe and kind.
A drover drifting over western plains. He's a city lad, a clock down Flinders Lane. They're in the trenches at Lone Pine and on the Flanders firing line.